But before we begin, I just wanted to get a general idea of the crowd over here. So how many of you here are system administrators or DevOps, system architects? What about the other guys? Are you guys developers? How many of you have actually had experience setting up a Linux server? Okay. So my talk is targeted at people who at least have some basic knowledge of setting up their own Linux shared server or a Linux server in general. So I'll try to keep the technical terms and as possible, and I try to explain the terms, but you'll probably have to later on go home and Google all the terms yourself. So I'll just start. So Endurance is basically a group of companies, and these are all the brands that are here at the Endurance office. Publicity about that company. These are all the technologies that we use in our company, and I don't actually use all of them. There are various teams that use them, but these are all the technologies that we use. So this is the goal of the talk. I'm going to just talk about some general terms that you should know about and that you should be confident in your application. And I've targeted all these applications, but I'm not going to be talking specifically about some application. I'll try to avoid that and try to talk as general as possible so we can use it for some other applications, like for web. I'm saying Nginx Apache, but you can use like HTTP or some other server that you want. And I'm just going to recommend some secure configurations. If someone disagrees with them, they can point out their opinion. I have no issues. So all these guidelines that I'm going to propose, they are already available online. You can search them, and the only thing is that they're all scattered all around the web. So you need to do a little bit of reading at various places. So what I'm doing is I'm just collating all that information here. So let's start with SSL. How many of you don't know what SSL is? So you use this to connect to your Linux server securely. And so these are some recommended configurations that you can use. The first thing is to disable remote login to the root account. That way no one can brute force your root password. The second thing is you should disable password-based authentication. So can anyone tell me what is another way to connect?
Key based authentication.
Yeah. So you can use an SSH key, and in that case you don't have to specify your password. So when you use password based authentication, your password is sent to the server over the network. But in case of an SSH key, the key is never transferred over the network. So that reduces the chances of it getting caught over the network. And another thing is X11 forwarding. So if you have, desktop environment running on your Linux server, then it makes sense to have X11 forwarding. Basically, to forward off the entire GUI of your server to your local machine. But if you're not using it, then it's better to disable it. The reason for this is to reduce the attack surface. So the minimum number of things that you require, you should only keep those enabled. Anything that you don't need, you should keep it disabled. Then, TCP keep-a-line. Has anyone heard about keep-a-line messages? Say, in HTTP or anywhere else? Anyone who's not heard about them? So what happens is, when you say connect to a server via TCP, you maintain a connection with the server. Now, if you're not using that connection actively, it's possible that the server would disconnect your connection and you would again have to reconnect to the connection takes some time, and if you want to avoid that, you can use keep alive messages. So basically your client sends a keep alive message telling, informing the server that keep this connection open, do not close it. Now, why am I saying that you should disable TCP keep alive messages and SSH? Does anyone know that? So what happens is, even though SSH creates an encrypted connection to your server, the problem is that these keep alive messages are sent outside of the encrypted channel. So they are sent over an unencrypted channel. So that's why you should keep this disabled. Now you would think that, okay, I've disabled this, now I'll get disconnected from my server. So that's not true. There's another setting called client interval, client So you can use that. That is much better because those messages are sent over the encrypted channel. SSH agent forwarding. So you can set up SSH agent on your server, and you can load up your private key in it, and then you connect to that server, and then from there you can connect to all your other servers. Such a configuration is called a jump box. So you connect to this jump box, and from there you can connect to all your other servers. So it makes sense to have SSH agent running there, but there's one problem. The SSH agent, right, it loads a key in its memory. And anyone who has access to that SSH agent on that server can use those keys to connect to the server. So for example, if someone has root access on that jump box, they can become your user, they can use the SSH key which is loaded in that agent, and they can connect to all the servers as your user. So this again is a security risk, so that's why you should keep it disabled. Okay, unless you really need it. TCP forwarding. So you can use SSH as a VPN like server. So you can so you connect to SSH, and then you forward your connection from there to all the servers that you want. So basically you're tunneling your connection over SSH. So unless you really need this, you should keep this disabled as well. What happens is, again, so basically what is happening here is, it's not really, there's some security risk with the implementation of TCP forwarding. What is happening is, because you're connecting from this tunnel or to other services, there might be some firewall set up saying that, okay, this database server which is behind your firewall can only be accessed by this specific server. And suppose this job, from if you say you're on your local machine and you access this data server via your jump box, then what happens is, you're bypassing that security firewall that has been set up. So the firewall is allowing access only to certain servers, and you're circumventing that by connecting over this SSH TCP forwarded channel. So you should keep it disabled unless you really need it. Okay. Your server should be configured to disconnect idle clients after a few minutes, say 2-3 minutes. If they're not using the connection, then just drop the connection. They can anyways connect again to the server. In case you want to have, if you have some long running command that you want to run on the server, you should probably be using some terminal multiplexer, some terminal emulator like VOBU or TMUX, Scream, etc. on your server, so that even if your connection gets disconnected, your command will continue running. Yeah, this is very obvious. Limit the number of authentication attempts per IP. So if you have, say, 2-1 incorrect authentication attempt, then the SSH should not allow more authentication attempts from that IP. Similarly, for the number of sessions per IP. So if you have two connections already connected, say, so don't allow a third connection for that same user from that IP. Now, sandbox privilege separation. What happens is, when a client first connects to the SSH server, the SSH server creates the program. It creates another unprivileged process which does the authentication of the connecting user. Now, once the authentication is successful, it will create another process which has the same privilege as the connecting user. So this way, what happens is, you're not doing the authentication and you're not doing the actual connection as the root user in SSH program. So this provides an additional layer of security wherein you can't just exploit the server because your SSH connection is can set up multi-factor authentication. So you can set up Google Authenticator. There is a open source project available. You just have to set install it on your server and just run it. If you create a OTP, like a time, it will create a time-based key that you can set up in your say Android app or
machine OS.
Sorry,
machine OS.
Yeah. Does anyone have any questions?
As you said in the jump box, we should not keep our keys. So if you are not going to keep our keys there, then have it locally, and then we have a jump box, and we can use that jump box directly to connect to some other server by bypassing it. I mean, it would be just a jump box, not exactly we are doing SSH in jump box and then SSH doing SSH to another server. In that case, how our key will get compromised? Just mentioned
I was talking the case where you are loading up your private key in the SSH agent on the jump box.
That would not be the case if you keep the key locally.
Or locally, yeah. Then it's fine. But yeah, then it's fine.
One more question. If we frankly use VPN in our setup, almost using either we have some jump box or last few box. Additionally, we keep sharing some VPN. It adds some more layers.
Right. But in this case, what is happening is in TCP forward, you're talking specifically about TCP forward.
In terms of limiting network access.
Right.
So unless and until one doesn't connect using authentication using VPN.
So in that case, what you do is you limit access to your database server. So that it, anyone connecting over, say, VPN can't access it directly. Only people who are actually inside the office can connect to it directly. So if that, you can do that if that is really required. Did that answer your question?
Yes. I'm asking that we can also have that we can use VPN.
How do you all do it? Big Bang? So you're connecting to the net and the browser, right?
Yeah, but we have VPNs.
How are you?
I don't know. Connecting to VPN adds too much additional security. What I'm saying is VPN doesn't add much more security than what SSH already provides. Cryptography in SSH is already very strong. So all you're doing is adding more bandwidth to your connection.
No, what you do is you basically don't allow access to any of your internal servers over public. You only allow them access to over VPN.
No, so for that you disable TCP forwarding on the jump box.
Yeah.
So for there you can configure that you can only connect to certain IPs.
Yeah.
Because otherwise you can forward anywhere. Right?
Yeah, so that you have to do it on the jump box.
Exactly. So that is the, I think, that's what you're talking about.
Right? Yeah, so if you haven't done that, then I'm suggesting that you keep it. So by default it does privilege separation, but it doesn't do sandbox. So there are three modes. One is no, yes, and there is sandbox. In sandbox it applies some more restrictions on the
authentication.
Yeah.
There is one of the settings which is pretty useful. For servers that are exposing the phone, better to change the default.
Yeah.
So for the SSH scan server.
But I think NMAP and all can still
detect.
It is still, it prevents the standard. Yeah, that is
one thing that you can. In that case, I would say enabling multi-factor authentication into this place.
Yeah.
There is open source as well, there is one dual security. It charges $1 or $2 per month.
There's nothing being transferred over the internet in this case. It creates a time-based key and you save that key when you're generating the key at the time of
the key. But so someone else also has a boot access to that.
They can see your key.
So someone else can use that for
my time. Yeah, so by default, Google Authenticator, the app on the Linux server will force you to set 6 0 in that case, the multi-factor authentication is because you're using a key which you currently have. The Google Authenticator code is there on the server, so someone can access that code, but they still can't get your private key which is there with you.
Yeah.
And you can, there is another thing that you can do. You can, yeah, it will be better. And this you can add password as well. So what it can do is it can first use SSH key to connect to the server. After that, once the encrypted channel has been set up, then you send it the password from your machine. Then after that you do, Google Authenticator. So you have three factors in there. Has anyone heard about TLS 1.3? No. So it's currently in development, but it's already being offered by some projects. Like, how many of you haven't heard of Cloudflare? Okay, so Cloudflare provides a CDN. It's a content distribution network. What it does is it caches the content of your server. In its on its server, and its servers are distributed all over the world. So when you try to access your website, it will serve content from the server closest to you. So your server might be say in India, but someone accessing it from US will get it served from the US Cloudflare server. It also offers DNS servers. So and plus, if anyone tries to attack your server, they have safeguards in place to mitigate such large-scale attacks. So they are offering TLS 1.3. So if you enable Cloudflare for your domain, you get that added benefit. So yeah, you can enable all these options and then in addition to having Cloudflare. So anyways, on your server in Nginx and Apache, you can enforce it to use only TLS 1.2. The only disadvantage is that old web clients like Explorer or some other older browser versions might not be able to connect to it. Maybe even older Android phones or some other OS phone might not be able to connect to the server using 1.2. So in that case, what you can do is you can enable TLS 1.1 and 1.0 as well. But I would recommend that you force all these clients to upgrade instead of you downgrading your server. You can set 1.2 as your minimum TLS voltage. Then you can also set enable a setting called prefer server cycle. So what it does is that when the connection is being established, the server will force the client to use only the ciphers that it is providing. The client might support a lot of old ciphers as well, which might not be secure. But the server will force this connection to use only the server cipher. You can specify these ciphers, these are secure. The just one thing I'll talk about, the EC and that stands for elliptic curve cryptography. So it's like this algorithm of that is being used is very fast, so your connection speed is not compromised. And DH stands for Diffie-Hellman, so again an algorithm that is known to be secure. So yeah. So the next setting that is there, it's using that elliptic curve, Diffie-Hellman cryptography, and you're telling it what kind of an algorithm to use for generating the key. So what basically happens in this case is you're creating an ephemeral key. Basically, the key that you're creating for this current secure connection will only be used for that, and after that, the keys will be destroyed. So when the keys are destroyed, no one can actually gain access to all the communication that happened over the secure channel. So that is what happens basically in these TLS sessions. Now I'm saying that you should set a session timer. So basically, this is what I'm talking about. The session keys that are being generated will be stored for say like an hour or so, and then after that you should destroy these keys. You should not use them again. So that ensures that if anyone gains access to the keys, they will not be able to use them later on. They'll only be able to use them for the current session. Session tickets. is when you are creating the initial secure channel, it takes some time for the TLS handshake to occur between your client and your server. So if you want to avoid making this handshake every now and then, what you can do is you can reuse the old keys that were generated in the previous session. Of course, there's a timeout that we have specified, but within that, say 1 hour, if you connected to the site for 5 minutes, after 20 minutes you're coming back to connect again. So you can reuse the old keys again. But what happens is that suppose someone gains access to these keys in that 20 minutes, then they can sniff on this secure connection, and basically they can impersonate the client or the server in that case. So what you should do is you should disable the SSL session ticket. Otherwise, what happens is currently there is no secure way for, there is no proper implementation in Apache or Nginx to rotate these keys. So it's best to just disable that. And what you can do is, when the session timeout is over, it will create a new session ID. Then iframe loading. So basically, what happens is sometimes, has anyone seen a phishing website? Or do you know what phishing is? So basically, you're impersonating another website. So in this case, what happens is, people can use iframe, wherein what they do is they try to load the actual website in an iframe in their own website. So it seems like it's the actual website which you're accessing, but whatever content that you're sending is going to the malicious server, and it's not going into the it's not going to the actual server, like the payment gateway or etc. whatever it is. So what you can do is you can tell the server to send a special header to the client saying that nothing should be loaded in iframes in your browser. So this will prevent the browser, this will ensure that the browser itself will not load anything in an iframe. Sniffing content type. So when you try to say access an image or a PDF file, you're already telling the client that this is the type of the file that I'm sending to you. But in some cases, the web browser can also try to guess the type of file that is coming. And some of these files could be executable files as well, which can run malicious code on your browser. So what you can do is you can set a header telling the web browser that do not try to sniff the type of content that I'm sending. I'll always tell you what type of content it is. If you can't guess it, don't load it. That is what you're saying. SSL stake link. So there's something called as CRL, certificate revocation list. So when a digital certificate, an SSL certificate is created, it has a time period associated with it. And once the time period is over, the certificate expires and you have to generate a new new certificate. So there is a certificate revocation list available, which the browser can query to see if the certificate being passed to it is actually valid or not. And this takes some time because it needs to load the entire list and then search inside that using a key. So another protocol is available. It's called OSCP, and that's the online certificate status protocol. Basically, what you do is your browser makes an API call to an OSCP server, and that server just responds saying that whether this certificate is valid or not. So that speeds up your process of connecting. So you can use that. Then next is HSTS. This is HTTP strict transfer transport policy. So what happens when you connect to a website? Suppose that website has SSL enabled. Say you're going to a bank's website. When you start typing, most people don't type HTTPS :// and then bank. You just type the name of the bank's website and they just press enter. So what happens is when the request goes to the bank server, it automatically sends the redirect request to the client and it redirects them to the HTTPS website. But what is happening in that initial communication, you're sending a request over an unencrypted channel. So it's possible for a man-in-the-middle attack to happen at this point, wherein someone intercepts that initial connection and they send redirect to some other malicious, say, phishing website. So what to mitigate that kind of an attack. New policy has been proposed. It's called HSTS. It's in production now. So what happens in this case is when the when you make the first connection over an encrypted channel HTTP, the server responds back saying that I have HSTS enabled. So so what the browser does is it will catch that response, the header, and from next time onwards, whenever the client types any non-HTTP URL for that domain, the browser itself will upgrade the connection to HTTPS. So there is no network traffic happening over here. It's the browser that is itself upgrading the connection to HTTPS. So there is no initial packet being sent here in that case. But remember, you already did one connection. You already did one HTTP connection to the server initially, right? Before the server can tell you that using HTTPS. So to mitigate that as well, there is a HSTS payload list which is maintained by Google, and that is loaded into all modern browsers like Chrome, Firefox, etc. So what happens is you submit your domain in that to that list, and that list is updated, and then when a new version of Firefox or Chrome or any other browser is installed on the machine, that new list is loaded in that as well. So when the when you type that HTTP domain name, what the browser does is it will check that list locally, and if it sees your domain in that list, it will automatically update the connection to HTTPS without making the first HTTP connection. So you can mitigate that initial attack surface as well. XSS, I think people would already know about that cross-site description. Yeah. So in this case, basically, what is happening is you are trying to load pages from some other domain for the current domain, and basically, it's possible that some other the other domain from where you are loading it might try to load some malicious current side. So your server can itself send a header saying that XSS is like scripting is not allowed. So when the browser tries to load the current page, it should see some script being loaded from some other domain. It will block that connection. It will only load script from the current domain. Now content security policy. It sometimes might happen that you actually have to load some scripts from some other domain. Like for example, fonts. If you're using Google Fonts, you need to load it from their server. If you are say using Discus for managing comments on your website, you need to load their scripts. So in this case, what you do is you set up content security policy in which you tell it, say fonts can only be loaded from this domain. Other scripts can only be loaded from this domain. So you can specify which type of scripts can be loaded from what domain. And the browser will ensure that only those domains are queried for those type of scripts. So that is content security policy. Cross-domain policy, again, we talked about that. So you can set it to none, and you can then specify a content security policy. Like this content should only be loaded from this. Referral policy. What happens is sometimes a user is on your website and then he clicks on an external link and goes to some other domain. Now when the customer is redirected to some other website, you can send a referral. A referral is basically the link of the original domain from where he was redirected. So in that you can specify what all parameters were present in the entire URL. You can give the entire URL. You can just send the main domain that was there from which the referrer was made. So you can set a policy over here. So it's better to keep it as the domain itself. The new domain will only get the name of the old domain from where it was referred. It won't get the entire URL. Sometimes the URL might contain some parameters that you don't want the other domain to know. That's about the guidelines for web server. Are there any questions?
Yes, so parameters,
This is specifically, I'm talking about Nginx. There is a similar setting that you can use. This format is basically in what you use in Nginx.
Because I had one query.
Yeah.
Are you connected to internet right now?
Yeah.
You open one site though.
My website?
No, my website. Cypher. LI.
.sp. Yeah, I have actually mentioned this site in my references. So basically you get all the configuration that you secure configuration for all the applications. So you have your web servers here, but you also have say HFproxy, you have mail server configuration, FTP, database, and SSH, etc. Even GoLang. So I mentioned this in my reference. So,
question was, if you go up towards Apache,
yeah.
You can see the condition there which says, you know, it requires Apache greater than 2.4.
Right.
So what will be your recommendation where you feel that somebody running an older version of Linux distribution, wherein the latest version of Apache is not available on that distribution. So you have to completely migrate to a new variant of the operating system. In that case, what do you recommend?
In that case, you can't use all these settings.
Right.
So in that case, yeah, the best option is to upgrade your OS.
Another option I can suggest
is offload SSL to, let's say, HAProxy or something like that. HAProxy is very light, you can compile it, no problem.
Yeah, that is one option.
But in the cloud, you have to see your first three clouds, right?
In fact, we have to use the chip.
You're not using the IBM?
No. So for us, basically, HAProxy requirement comes not from SSL overloading, but from AR7 separation.
Okay.
So we anyways have to use HAProxy. We might as well use all the features that it offers.
How about you guys?
So in that case, obviously what can happen is the load balancer can forward it to HAProxy in our case. So your SSL termination can be handled by the cloud load balancer. HAProxy does the job of layer 7 separation.
There's another hop in that, that's the only thing.
But advantage is that I can then auto-scale HAProxy's.
Because usually if I want to go, I mean, why I go to cloud is because I want to, this heading should not be my heading. My heading is the app.
So in that case, again, you can use something like
CloudFed.
Yeah. So they handle all your SSL.
That's okay, but it's as long as you want to use it as a CDN.
Yeah.
If you are providing an API service or something like that, where you know the response is not cacheable.
Okay. I would suggest best practices to terminate SSL on load balancing, maintain the growth, and only for certain traffic, either a batch or API traffic load balancer.
Yeah, that's exactly what we do now.
In Cloudflare, you can specify certain URLs as not to be cached.
The entire product is API.
It's same with AWS CDN. There are a lot of options around Cloudflare, AWS CDN.
AWS comes now ELB, before they had the ELB,
which is
like the OSI 3 level only.
Yeah.
So now with the OSI 7, level 7.
It's recent addition.
Recent? 6 months ago.
Now they have internet.
We've been running HAProxy for like 4 years now.
I'm just saying, 6 months is very old in cloud. You wouldn't know, like, aaj subah dikhe wo shit call exchange rahe, ye bhi change ho gaya.
So in case you're using, say, Cloudflare or something, they also provide an extra option. It's called a client, you can specify a client certificate. So you can tell your server that only clients who provide this client certificate are allowed to connect to this.
That can happen on with normal web servers as well.
Yeah. So basically your client, your web server only responds to requests from your load balancer when it provides the client service, and everyone else has to connect to your load balancer.
5 minutes.
So main server. So I'm suggesting you disable POP3 and IMAP. How will you load your mail? No, so you don't, you're not running your mail. Any suggestions? So I'm just saying you disable POP3, but I'm not saying you disable POP3S. And similarly for IMAP, you disable IMAP but not IMAPS. So basically you use a secure version of these protocols to connect to your server and load your download your mail or view them. So there are different ports on which the other protocols run, IMAPS and POP3S. So basically what you can do is you can block the POP3 and IMAP ports itself in the firewall and only allow access to the secure version. So again, then in that case, you can directly use TLS 1.2 and you can specify a cipher list. And there are some ciphers that you should not be using because it has been disclosed that they are insecure and they can be cracked. So there are some, you can actually specify in say dovecot that do not use these ciphers. Then next thing is SPF. That's the sender policy framework. What basically it does is the mail along with in collaboration with DNS. What you do is you set a key in your DNS, that is your public key, and you have the SPF private key on your so when the mail is sent, it will get tagged with that private key. That signature will get added to the mail, and so when the so in SPF, what you do is you select the IPs that are allowed to send mail from for this domain. So in that case, when the remote server receives a mail, it can check that okay, mail is coming from this IP, so it's allowed. If it's not, then you can set a policy whether it can actually discard the mail or it can allow the mail but with a warning saying that this has not come from the one of the IPs from where it's allowed. So that is SPF. Then there is DKIM, where you have a private key on your server and you have a public key which you mention in your DNS. And what happens is the entire header and the body of your mail is signed using your private key, and that signature is added as a digital signature in your header of the mail. And when the remote mail server receives the mail, it can verify whether this mail has actually come from your server by using the public key that's available in your DNS to decrypt that signature. Now what happens is when you're using DKIM, the mail might go through a lot of hops in between and your headers might keep changing in that case. So each layer of mail server that comes in between will add another header saying that okay, this mail was processed from this server and it has been forwarded. In that case, in DKIM, you can tell it that you can use a relaxed mode of signature for the header and a different type of signature mode for the body. So the body will not change with what you are saying, and the header might change with some addition. So that is that. Spam assassin is for scanning spam mail. And RBL is remote blocker. So basically there are providers like Spamout which provide a list of spam sending servers. They provide their IP. So you can check whether the mail that is coming to your server is from one of these IPs. And you can directly block mail from that IP. That may be for scanning and for viruses in your mail. So again, the mail that comes in can be scanned by maybe for viruses, like especially for attachment. You should disable the SMTP banner. So when you connect to your server, it will tell some, give some information like what type of mail server it's running, what is the OS version, etc. So if you disable that, then people have more difficulty in figuring out what type of server you're running and trying to attack them. And your MTA should always handle mail only for your own domain. It should discard all other domains. You shouldn't allow unauthenticated mails. all mail that are sent have to be authenticated against the email ID. Unknown mail from unknown senders from your server should be blocked. And of course your server, when it's receiving mail from a remote server, it should again check SPF, DKIM, and then pass the mail to spam assassin and planning VPN. Anyway.
Apart from SPF and DKIM, this is for anyone.
Okay.
Okay. That is also useful. Or cannot be blocked by SPF and DKIM.
Can you just give it give a brief?
So it's a technology similar to DKIM. Like actually authenticates the sender.
Okay.
So that authentication is done between the two servers. Based on the policy that. The way you introduce, for example, Outlook.com has never marked after long time. The way they did that is initially started with SPF and then with KM and then that's how it should be on the policy. Because otherwise it is disruptive for your network. But yeah, we can look it up what it is.
Anyone using Vipa?
No, Microsoft uses it, but
yeah.
I don't know.
I don't feel like
the large providers was customer. Other thing is internal user servers. This we often find in MS. Don't check who's sending the mail. So I can send a mail as an email. And that's what leads to business email compromise. So all internal emails should be automated.
Yeah.
Now, can you speak up?
Just for the camera. Yeah. So what I'm saying is internal email should be authenticated using SMTP auth. That's to prevent business email compromise from internal domains. Because often organizations have many sites and they're pulling emails from these sites into a central location and then sending it out or circulating internally. But none of these email servers often have any kind of rentals, which is already listed here. Easy targets for internal
I think you should be an idea. This is a scenario that you have like multiple
using using DMs.
Actually, what we have found is some people have not even implemented things like SPF and DKIM and all that. So first we need to do that. Prevent this.
Also, when you enable TLS authentication, TLS security, right? If the remote server also supports it, the connection between your remote and your mail server will happen over an encrypted and the other thing that you can do is you can use PGP. So you can sign and encrypt your mail. So the signature tells the receiver that it has actually come from the sender and not from anyone else. And the encryption is for the receiver, so that only the receiver can read the mail and no one else can read it. So that gives you end-to-end security in case of mails.
Can you just repeat the feature he was talking about? I have not heard
of it. DMARC.
DMARC.
D-M-A-R-C. There are a lot of settings, like the link which I just showed, that has some settings, but I'm just going to talk about some basic things. That is, you should always have some username password set for all your users, and you should use strong passwords, shouldn't use weak passwords. For example, if you're using MySQL, it can enforce strong passwords for all the users. You should have access control, so the user that is connecting, it should only be allowed connections from certain IPs, certain host IPs, or from local hosts. And also that user who is connected should only have access to certain databases, certain tables, or if you're using, say, MongoDB, then certain connections, certain documents, certain connections in the database. And it should also, restrict the type of action that it can take. Like, is it allowed to write to the database or only read from it, etc. Enforce encryption. So this is encryption. encryption when you are connecting over a over the network. So that is very easy to implement. You can use SSL cert for that to enforce it. There is another type of encryption which is encryption at rest. So in that case, the database the file that stores your data, that itself is encrypted and stored on the disk. Of course, this adds another layer of you can take a performance hit because of that. But if your data is very critical, then you should have encryption at rest as well. So if you're using MongoDB, you need the enterprise version to be able to use encryption at rest. But encryption over the network is easily possible in the community version. Do not run your database server as well. It should be run as a separate unprivileged user which only has access to the tasks that are required for the database application. And use a firewall to restrict access from only those hosts which are allowed to connect to the database. So only your application or your web server should be allowed to access the database server. No one else should be allowed to access it. So if you want some kind of a staging environment, they should have a separate staging server which is given access to that. And not individual developers' machine IPs. Any queries?
How much time you
have? Just done. This time there's 1%. The slides are getting shorter. Yeah, FTP, just don't use plain FTP at all. You can use SFTP, which is FTP over SSL. In this case, again, you can use SSH keys and you can use multi-factor authentication, etc. Or you can use FTPS. So in that case, if the FTP server itself will handle the TLS SSL connection. And don't allow anonymous login. Anonymous login is where you're using a username, but there's no password associated with it. Of course, you can restrict such an anonymous user to a certain folder only, but it's better to keep it disabled. So if you want to serve some data to a lot of users, it's better to just use, say, HTTP instead of using FTP with anonymous login. And so suppose you're using pure FTPD software, it can scan the file which is uploaded. So when the file is uploaded, the file path is handed over to a script, an external script. In that script, you can use, say, Cry Baby or something to scan the file. If it's a malware file, you can take action. So VPN. If you're using OpenVPN, there are these set of scripts. Yeah, you can do that as well on the Linux server. So that partition itself, when you're mounting it, you can set it so that you can't have the executable scripts done from that partition. So there's a set of scripts, easy RSA. You can use that to generate a server key, a client key, and an extra key called a pre-shared key. So this pre-shared key will be used for TLS authentication. So basically you have three keys. One key which is available with the server, one with the client, and the third key is available with both the client and the server. Then diffie-hellman parameters can be specified. You can use 2048 because it's pretty difficult to go to 40, but I would recommend 4090 because servers and clients are now powerful enough to take care of the extra threats in the encryption. Use TLS 1.2, but the problem is that current clients that are available, they don't support all the TLS 1.2 ciphers. Like for example, OpenVPN will provide a client for Android that doesn't support TLS 1.2 cipher. So in addition to TLS 1.2 ciphers, I've also specified some older ciphers, TLS 1.0 ciphers. So at least these clients can connect to it. They'll use TLS 1.2 protocol, but they'll use older ciphers. And if it's a Linux laptop or a Windows laptop, they already support TLS 1.2 ciphers. So some parameters that you can pass when the server will push to the client. Basically, what you're doing is you're telling it not to use the gateway of your local machine, or tell it to use the gateway which the server is pushing to it. And with that def one, what it does is it doesn't delete your local machine's gateway. It just overrides it with the gateway that's provided by the server. And you're bypassing DNS and DHCP. So what happens is all traffic goes through the VPN. There is no traffic being leaked from your laptop. Like, it's not going over your normal internet connection. It will always go through the VPN connection. So that ensures that there is no leakage of data. So there's a hashing algorithm that is being used when the data is being passed between the server and the client over the encrypted channel. They use a stronger algorithm. And when the client connects to the server, the client can check if it's an actual client that is connecting or it's trying to impersonate the server. So similarly, the client can also make this kind of a thing. So that could be checked. And again, you can use multi-factor authentication. These are some extra things that you can do. You can set up auditing on your servers to know what kind of action, what file was created, what device, like network device was created, etc. By me. Yeah. You can use something called Linus. So it's something like Nessus scan what you had shown earlier. What it does is it runs the application on your server and it scans on the configuration file and it suggests some improvement that you can make to make it more secure for your application. The other two, CSK Rootkit, RK Hunter, they are for searching for rootkits on your server and malware basically, and ClamAV specifically for scanning malware on your server. Does anyone have any queries in the previous?
Yes, yeah, how does that do this? Yeah.
SQL injection with respect to database servers.
Okay.
Want to know about it?
I'm not sure about that. Maybe I'll take him to talk more about
it. What's your question?
SQL injection attacks. I don't know.
It's actually an injection attack that happens via the application.
Okay.
So, for example, you may have, let's say, a page. Okay. Let's say a product page. So URL looks like http://abc.com/products.php ?product ID = 500, for example. So basically it's actually referring to the column and the data which is residing in the database. So what if I can actually tell database, okay, I want to see 500, along with that I want to see the password for the DB account. You can actually execute a query through the application and the coding is not done securely, you can actually dump the entire database from the application. So it's an application model.
But what are the remedies for this?
Remedies, you have to securely code the application. Okay. Code should not, the query should not be executed directly, on the server. So you have to use something called as parameterized query.
Okay. Nice prepare statement. They all
prepare statements.
All these are done.
So basically, you need to validate your endpoints, and once that validation is done, only then you should do further processing.
So there is always this, right? I mean, at the server level, you said when you get input, you do all these input validations, SQL, whatever happens. It's just like saying, okay, man, if this country 0005, which is pin code, that kind of input validation you do. as a server when you get this, okay, whether this is actual text or like some bloody old text that is coming through, that has to be the answer.
And at another level, you can actually manage permissions, user account permissions.
Once.
Yeah. This is one of the resources we find useful that we use for the website called CI
Security.
Can you share this?
I
am not sure.
What is that?
CI
Security.
I think it was coming for that. So what is it?
But we got that.
So folks can go here. What these guys do is they develop security benchmarks for lots of technologies. It could be your Apache engine, MySQL, anything, even OS. So whatever we talked about, a lot of those settings and plus whatever additional more, just fill in multiple documents in SQL reference. That will help you adopt your system.
Sorry, which one?
Center of Internet Security. It's me, just
yeah, but I'll have to add you first.
Share some.
It's not much known outside security services, but it's very useful.
That needs to be
on my own security.
So that also like when you are running one more thing is, what Aditya had talked about patch, having the latest patches installed. So generally patches to the kernel on in Linux require you to reboot the machine. Any other application level patches require you to restart that server. But in Linux you have certain methods to not require the reboot as well. So for example, if you are using CentOS or like any Red Hat based system, you can use the service called kernelcare provided by Cloud Linux. What they do is they backport all the security patches to your current kernel, and they apply those patches in memory, and that way you don't have to reboot your machine. So basically those patches are just functions that are being called by your kernel, right? What it does is basically changes the reference to the function. The old reference is removed and the kernel is made to use the code from the new reference, which is basically your new patch function. So that, and if you're using Ubuntu, even they provide Canonical provide the service where they patch your current kernel. It's called like live patch server, and you don't have to reboot your machine. So all your security patches are applied. There's no reason not to apply security. Yeah, even if you can't give an excuse saying that you have to report the server and I can't do that with customers, senior, client.
So usually now, see, this is I think becoming maybe 10, 5, 2 years, 3 years back, this kind of practice. Now it's even cloud and all, I would do only because I wouldn't really care about it.
This is for like, say, hosting.
Even hosting, I mean, even hosting actually, because you have so many number of servers, I'll say, okay, these X numbers I will keep for rolling a bit. These I'm diverting our traffic, I'll go sort of test this very thing.
What if you can't divert traffic? What if you all your customers think you're on one shop? So maybe
that's
a shared
problem. That's your bigger problem, this is not your problem.
If you're not providing cloud hosting, if you're doing normal shared hosting, then in that case, all these technologies are.
Okay, any questions? One.